I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Ken Platt's Gymkhana Foul Play. The Princess Stakes Murder. Starring Howard Duff. Julie Adams. And Ray Danton. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
the makers of Contact and Chevrolet. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Private Detective Max Roper went to Delmar at the request of a friend to watch the running of the Princess Stakes. His friend, jockey Willie Rich, scored a win, but placed out of the money. He showed up a day later, dead. And in his quest to find out why, Max Roper has met a most peculiar array of characters. Among them, two bunco artists, a former Mr. Universe, and a hostile athlete's agent. And he arranged to meet a young girl in Lake Tahoe, who he had known only as a voice on the telephone. But she'd nothing to say, because she was dead. Max Roper has his work cut out for him. Two unsolved murders, a missing heiress, and he's about to confront a man with a pistol who's firing bullets into a target. The target is the full front figure of a man. The Princess Stakes Murder will continue after this.
It looked like graduation day at FBI school. Boxes and clips of ammunition were stacked on a range table. An automatic 12-gauge shotgun and various expensive-looking handguns, sight scopes, and holsters. Several framed targets with the bullseye centers well perforated with accurate fire had been discarded and leaned against the side. It told me that rugged individualist Tyler Clayton had no intention of calling in the authorities to find his daughter. He could do the job himself. That last was pure show-off. Clayton had known I was standing there all along. He spun the gun like Billy the Kid, turned to me, and extended the gun butt first. A handsome Colt Python 357 Magnum, a gun developed for police use. Its load would penetrate both armor and glass.
Care to try your luck, son?
No, thanks, Mr. Clayton. I can't get mad at a target, not today anyway.
A drink, then? Now, let's see, bourbon, wasn't it?
Heard anything from your daughter?
Not a word.
Nothing?
You got it right, son. Nothing.
It took me by surprise the way he whirled toward the target and snapped off a quick shot from the hip and put a hole an inch to the right of the black center X. Then, just as quickly, he was back to his drink, grinning. He reloaded and slipped the shooter into a shoulder rig holster and jerked it into place. You carry that gun on you usually?
Sometimes.
Happens to be a pretty deadly weapon. One of the few handguns around that can surely kill a man.
I know, son.
You can't be certain yet your daughter's been kidnapped. You might kill somebody by mistake.
When I kill somebody, son, it's no mistake. Grew up with a gun in my hands.
Where would that be? Texas?
Hell no, not Texas. Saskatchewan.
Canada?
Yes, sir. Grew up there. Did plenty of hunting when we were kids, me and my brothers. Lots of game up there, son.
Rabbits?
Rabbits, fox, moose, bear. Got my first grizzly with a handgun when I was 14. That was a kill, boy. That was some kill.
You have to be pretty crazy to tangle with a grizzly with it. I'm wondering, would you take a chance like that today?
Hell yeah. Been a hunter all my life. Oh, hello, sweetheart.
Good to see you again, Mr. Roper.
Good to see you too, Mrs. Clayton. Again.
Was that you shooting, Tyler?
You know it was me. Who else could it be?
Mr. Roper, have you found Pam?
Is that what you want?
Of course.
I wasn't sure. All I got from you was a little 4x5 picture off the desk. Apart from that, neither of you gave me anything that would help. No description, no background. I assume she's gone to school, had some boy or girl friends. At 22, she's bound to have some habits. She must go places.
Really, Mr.
Now, Roper? Listen here, boy.
Don't call me boy, and you listen. With your kind of power, if you took your daughter's disappearance seriously, you'd have brought in the Marines by now. You know what, Mr. Clayton? I don't think you want your kid found. Not yet, anyway. If so, that's your business. But you're playing a dangerous game, like hunting.
Now, I told you I wanted her found, and I want her found. Just because you've been dragging your heels don't mean you can turn on me. What's holding you up, money? Money, get my checkbook.
Don't bother. Let me tell you how I spent last evening, finding a murdered girl up in Tahoe. She wasn't your daughter, but she could have been. So your money is no guarantee your kid will be found alive.
I don't feel well.
You'll feel worse when I tell you the dead girl lived around here, worked at your favorite spa, the Gilded Cuckoo. Know her, Mrs. Clayton? The receptionist, Bonnie Burns?
Bonnie? Dead? Was she drowned? Like Willie Rich?
No, she never made it to the lake. The knife in her back slowed her down.
Now, look what you've done. You've upset my wife. Now, maybe this Bonnie did work at the spa, so what? What the hell are you driving at anyway?
She could have been murdered by mistake. About the same age as your daughter. Looks some like her, too, judging from the picture I have. The thing that puzzles me, although she was a natural redhead, Bonnie Burns had a blonde wig. And there are other things that don't ring right. She left the Gilded Cuckoo on her vacation Monday afternoon about the same time your daughter was supposed to be there. I don't know why she wore the blonde wig. Maybe the killer didn't know either. Maybe he thought she was your daughter when he put the knife into her back.
Oh, why don't you go inside, Monica? You're looking mighty pale.
Clayton, make Mr. Roper understand that Pam never did get to the spa for her hair appointment. They told me she hadn't been there at all on Monday, didn't even have an appointment. She lied to me when she said that's where she was going.
A couple things we ought to clear up, Mrs. Clayton. Your stepdaughter had a standing appointment at the spa.
How did you
know? And Bonnie Burns was at her reception desk at the Gilded Cuckoo that morning. If Pam came in and did keep her appointment, Bonnie saw her. If somebody there wanted that kept a secret, they've made sure of it. Bonnie can't tell anybody now whether your daughter was there or not. I left the Claytons, the beautiful people. He stood there tall, wearing his invincible look, arm around his wife. I felt the whole scene we just played had been just that, a scene, not a shred of truth in it. Clayton couldn't see his wife's face, but I could. It was pressed tight against his chest. And on it was a familiar look. The same tense, frightened expression I'd seen outside the Wiltshire Playhouse in the back seat of the car she was sharing with Lewis Charnock. I headed for Pacific Coast Highway, wondering when I'd get a break in this case, a lead to something tangible. At the edge of the village, I found it. A new shopping center sprawled over a large city block. I recognized the slim, dark-haired girl putting her groceries into the rear of a red station wagon. I drove into the lot. Hello. Aren't you the Clayton's maid?
Maid, yeah. Cook, too. And now I'm shopping for dinner. You are the policeman who came the other day, no?
Detective. I'd like to ask you some questions, Miss...
Pauli Lundgren. You have no word of Miss Pam yet?
It would help if you'd tell me about her.
What can I tell? I'm working there just past 1 year. Since the other Mrs. Clayton died.
Well, what did the other Mrs. Clayton die of?
In the heart, I think.
You were there when she died?
Yes, the last month. My father in Sweden was a doctor, and so I know about being a nurse. I helped out, and Miss Pam liked me, and I liked her, and so I stayed on.
Did Miss Pam ever disappear like this before?
Disappear? No. She was away to college. She's now just graduated.
I thought all Swedish maids said yeast.
They are the ones from Denmark.
I see. How did Pam get along with her new mother?
It is not right I should talk about the people I work for.
I'm trying to help Pam, don't you see? If I can't learn something about her, I have no way to find her. Help me, Polly.
I try.
Good. Was she unhappy since her father remarried?
Not right away, but yes, in a few months. They did not talk to each other so much, like strangers, I think.
Tell me, Polly, has anything happened at the Clayton house recently that struck you as strange, out of the ordinary, different?
I do not have much time. I am expected at the house.
Polly, please, think. Anything different?
Well, there was the letters. They made Mr. Clayton very angry.
Letters? When was this?
Soon after they got married, after Mrs. Monica came into the house.
Addressed to Mr. Clayton?
Yes. They came regularly, once a month.
Would you know what was in them?
How would I know that? Does he read his letters to his housemaid?
Try to remember. Was there a return address?
No. But they are made from Mexico. This I noticed. A very strange stamp.
Uh-huh. You said Mr. Clayton became angry. Did he say anything you'd recall?
Something. One time, about how he was not going to let somebody twist him around the finger.
Did he discuss the letters with Mrs. Clayton?
Oh, I have not heard this, but lately they have not been no more.
Do you think they may have concerned his daughter?
Please, if I do not get back to the house...
Just another minute, Polly. There's more, isn't there? More you're not telling me.
All right. The telephone calls. At first for the master, but he becomes very angry, shouts loud, and hangs up. And later the calls will come again, but this time he would ask for Miss Clayton, Pam.
Did Pam speak to the caller?
Only one time, but just for a moment. Her father heard. He came into the room, red in the face and shouting. He almost breaks the telephone. He puts it down so hard. Then he's telling her she's not to take any more calls from this person.
And that's it?
And there is some more. A few weeks ago, 2 weeks, a man came to the house, a stranger. Yeah? He's looking around very carefully. He asks, is Miss Clayton home? Pamela, he says, not Pam. I say the truth, she's not. And then he asks when Mr. and Mrs. Clayton will be home, and I tell him they have gone to look at some horses.
Did he give his name?
He's about to. Then he changes his mind, and he writes something very fast on a piece of paper from a notebook. He gives it to me and says, please, it is for Miss Pamela.
Did you see what he wrote?
A telephone number. I left it on the dresser in her room, but I think she did not get it.
Why? Clayton got there first?
I think it was Mrs. Monica. I'm not sure, but she was upstairs. And when I asked Miss Pam later if she got a note, she said, what note? And then she becomes very pale, very quiet.
Can you tell me what this stranger looked like?
A big man, like you, but more thin in the stomach.
You seem to concur with the diagnosis of the gilded cuckoo.
I beg pardon?
Never mind. What kind of car did he drive?
Oh, no car. He came by taxi. It waits for him. And now I must hurry back to prepare dinner.
One more question, Polly. Labor Day, Monday. Where were Mr. and Mrs. Clayton that evening?
At home. We had a very big party. He wins an imported horse race, no?
Willie Rich won it. Was Pam Clayton at the party?
No, and I go now.
All right, Polly.
Oh, I just remember something.
Yes, isn't so bad if what you remember is important.
I know what the man said when he was leaving. To the cabbie he said it. Okay, back to the Rover House, he said.
Uh-huh. One more favor, Polly. Don't tell anyone what you just told me.
Okay. Now, you will find Miss Pam?
Yes, as soon as I can. The Rover House was on the outskirts of Old Delmar. I asked the beauty behind the registration desk if anybody had blown in from Mexico within the past few weeks.
We have a Mr. Hunter, Mr. Thomas Hunter from Acapulco.
Is he in?
I'm sorry, sir, no.
Has he checked out?
No, he just hasn't been in.
Well, what do you mean?
I really don't know, sir. He left early one morning and didn't come back.
Which morning?
Labor Day.
This one's a real lady. Never tries to kick me.
Can we talk, Joey?
Sure. Come on outside. Let's have a cigarette. How's it going? Getting anywhere?
If I am, I don't know about it. Tell me, did Pam Clayton spend much time down here?
Yeah, quite a bit. We got that filly of hers, you know, Mary Jane. Good 2-year-old.
How did she act? Throw her weight around or anything?
Nah, that kid never made waves. You'd never know she was worth a zillion on the hoof. Nobody knows she was alive.
They still don't.
She'll turn up. It's only been 3 days.
I found one last night that only took 12 hours.
A stiff?
Kid from around here. Shivving her back. All right, Joey, let's have it. You've been holding out.
You're punchy. What would I know?
I understand a stranger's blown into town and trying to contact Clayton's daughter. I figure a smart operator would track her down here once he found out horses are her hobby. There's more, Joey. This dude came straight from Mexico. He checked in at the Rover House. He's been trying to see Pam. He's also been missing since Labor Day morning. All right. Anytime you're ready, Joey.
Willie set it up. I don't think the dude's exactly a stranger. I think Willie knew him from way back.
Willie set what up?
The guy came down here a couple of weeks ago. I'm not sure if he met Clayton's kid here or not. All I know about is Labor Day, and I know about that because Willie told me.
Well, clear it up for me. It's still muddy.
Well, the Clayton kid had a morning appointment at the Gilded Cuckoo Spa out in Poway. Willie must have set it up for the dude to meet her here and forgot about her beauty parlor bit. So Willie drops over here early that morning to give me a message to forward to the guy that she wasn't stiffing him on purpose, but that she had this other operation going, see?
Was the guy's name Hunter?
Yeah, I guess so. Seems old man Clayton wasn't keen about them getting together. So, like I said, Willie set it up. Hunter shows up here a little after 10. He looks put out when the kid isn't here. So I told him what Willie said. He took off right away.
With the Gilded Cuckoo? To meet her there?
He didn't say. He just flipped.
She's been missing since. Hunter, too. You think they went off together?
Beats the hell out of me. He was old enough to be an old man. Maybe he was an uncle or something. Might have acted like one.
The other Mrs. Clayton's brother?
If you ask me, he looked more like Clayton.
Describe him.
Tall man, thin, big hands, in his 50s. Tough looking. Could have been a fighter. Knife scar on his cheek. His nose is broke. Kind of quiet, though. Didn't talk much.
You sized him up pretty good. Funny you didn't mention him before.
Well, you know how it is.
No, I don't, but go on. You're saying Willie set it up. Now, what I have to know is, did Clayton's kid want to meet him? Did she ever meet him?
I can't give it up, pal, but I figure Willie was straight. If he said it was okay, then it was okay.
It's good to hear you speaking well of Willie, after he took away a pretty good record you once rang up.
Ah, records. You know what's not in the books? When I was all busted up, Willie paid the hospital bills. Willie got me the job here. Maybe it don't look like much, but horses are my life. And I still got one mark up. Willie would have taken it for sure, but he's gone now. I still got that, whatever good it does me.
Does you a lot of good, Joey, if you didn't knock off Willie.
Which reminds me, you were supposed to be working on that one. But you're spending all your time looking for Clayton's kid. Maybe you're being faked out on that play.
Maybe. Tell me, did Pam Clayton ever come here with a girl about her age named Bonnie Burns? Redhead?
Not that I remember. Why?
She's the one somebody knifed up in Tahoe last night. She worked at the Gilded Cuckoo.
Then what are you doing here?
Business hadn't slowed noticeably at the Gilded Cuckoo, judging from the number of cars lining the parking lot. I was becoming irritated with the missing girl, with the Claytons' unorthodox approach toward handling it, and with myself for becoming involved with a case that didn't make any sense. I took my light traveling bag out of my car and walked through the heavy gilded doors again. The leggy, gray-eyed Miss Hill, whom I'd seen at the reception desk before, was gone. In her place was another of the same mold, young, cute, and friendly. Hello. Where's Bonnie?
Bonnie?
Bonnie Burns. She used to work here.
Oh, I couldn't tell you. I'm new here.
What about Miss Hill? She around?
I think she went back to therapy. Do you have an appointment?
A standing one.
He'll be right out, Mr. Roper. Why don't you sit over there?
Thank you.
Oh, Mr. Roper. Now, do I understand correctly that you are serious this time?
Well, I was serious the other time, but I had to make sure I could take a holiday from my outfit.
I understand. I don't believe you told me what business you were in.
Insurance. The company doctor told me I was 10 pounds overweight. That's when I decided to do something about it.
Well, I don't think you have much of a problem. Any, take Mr. Roper's bag. Through this door, Mr. Roper. We'll get you settled. Oh, by the way, girl you asked about last time, Miss Clayton, I suppose she's returned home by now.
I imagine so. I've been so busy, I haven't had a chance to check.
Well, there you are. It never pays to get excited over these things. Probably all a little misunderstanding.
Probably.
Well, here we are. It's a small room, but more than adequate.
Bars at the window?
Oh, you'd be surprised how desperate these dipsos get for a drink. They'll try any means of escape. Now, Mr. Roper, if you just take off your clothes and put on these pajamas.
At this time of day?
Well, your clothing will be returned to you. You understand, of course, that we must remove all incentives for you to leave if the going gets tough.
With that, he walked out, leaving me with Ernie, who could have passed for King Kong's twin brother. Ernie was very helpful, I'll say that for him. He put all my clothes into the closet and locked it. Standing barefoot in just a pair of pajamas in a barred room doesn't give a man a feeling of confidence. I was looking at those very real bars when I realized Glendon had come back into the room. He had a shot glass in his hand.
Yeah, drink hearty. Go on, it's our own secret little brew. Believe me, it'll take away your desire for liquor for at least 24 hours.
It was a cloudy mixture with the fragrance of steamed cauliflower. I took a deep breath, tilted my head, tossed it down, and handed the glass to Ernie, and felt my knees buckle at the same time. I felt suddenly very hot, and the room seemed to rock under my feet. On Glendon's face was an expression of purely benign curiosity. Another one of my feelings was coming on, but slowly, very slowly, I found myself tilting forward, and as the last red rocket blasted off inside my skull, I knew that I was in for trouble. Big trouble.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Princess Stakes Murder. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. Max Roper, private investigator, hunch player, and karate expert, is having his problems. Nothing seems to point the way to the murder of his friend, Jockey Willie Rich. What he has found is another murder. That of young Bonnie Burns, the warm and willing receptionist of the Gilded Cuckoo Health Spa. The investigation has led Roper from Willie's murder to Pam Clayton's disappearance, to backtracking into Pam's stepmother's checkered marital career, to a demonstration of Tyler Clayton's expertise with firearms, to the knowledge that there is a mystery man somewhere named Thomas Hunter who may have something to do with all of it. But as of the moment, Max Roper is in no position to inquire any further. He is now a client of the Gilded Cuckoo in a barred room, his clothing locked away, and having just swallowed a prescribed elixir, is in the process of crashing into black oblivion. Is this any way to treat a detective? In a moment, Max Roper will be treated to a ride on a diabolical machine called the Isotron as the Princess Stakes Murder continues.
I tried to raise my head, but couldn't. I heard a soft gushing of voices. My vision cleared temporarily, and I saw a chunky, light-haired man standing next to Glendon. He wore light-rimmed eyeglasses, and I knew I'd seen him before. I knew his name was Dorn, but I couldn't figure why he was looking down at me. I tried to raise myself up to ask him, but there were solid straps of tight canvas lashing me securely to the bed. I didn't need anything more to tell me that once again I had miscalculated my moves and underestimated theirs. I shook my head and tried to growl and fell asleep instead. I was getting pretty good at that.
He's coming around.
I was on my back, tilted toward the ceiling. Square tiles shifted in and out of focus and finally settled into a pattern that held. I began to understand that I was lying on a tilted, narrow board barely wide enough for my frame. My feet rested on an angled slab at the bottom. I recognized the contraption as an exercise slant board used in gyms. I'd been on one before, but never with my arms tied behind the board. Apparently, I was going to be introduced to a new exercise. I looked down past my nose to the straps bisecting my body. My upper torso was stripped bare. Wires were strung along me at intervals extending out of view. Pain parted my scalp. Phantom fingers of metal told me to lie there quietly and not move.
He's ready now.
I wanted to laugh and tell him he was ridiculous. A million volts of concentrated force hit me in the back. My body tensed and surged upward, tearing the breath out of me. I settled back, nerves quivering and jiggling, and waited for the next one. A strange smell filled my nostrils. I identified it immediately. The musky scent of fear. My cortex knew what my body didn't. That I was going to be tickled to death. I was ready when it came, but it didn't help. The contact wire bit into my flesh. I leaped.
Why are you here, Mr. Roper?
I could have told him, because I was a dumb dick.
We're waiting for an answer.
My entire upper left quadrant recoiled in a monstrous heave.
I'm sure you understand that your body of nerves will give out long before this machine. Now, I ask you once more, why are you here?
I told you, to get in shape, to take weight off. The contact pad on my left side jumped. Electricity hammered into my nerves and muscles. I twitched like a harem hopeful in a shimmy contest. I shivered and shot uncontrollably. Each contact stimulated another mass of ganglia into pulsed reflex. I expected at any moment a contraction severe enough to snap a bone. What the hell's going on? You treat all your customers this way?
I'm asking you once more. What are you looking for?
If you think I'm keeping something back, why haven't you clowns thought of using sodium pentothal? That's supposed to be pretty good for digging out the truth.
Yeah, but the acetron is more memorable. It might even deter you from seeing us again.
You're wrong, sweetie pie. What I'm going to do to you when I get out, that's the thing I'm going to remember.
Well, let's have one more for the road for Mr. Roper.
It was a beaut, but it didn't break my back. Dr. Savage came forward again. I saw the hypo in his hand and foolishly tried to draw away. The wires held me in place. My forearm was swabbed and the needle went in.
You might like this one. It's PCP, the peace pill. It's good for hallucinations, delusions, and possibly a depressed state. Why are you here? What do you want? What are you looking for?
My field of vision began to whirl. Before my eyes, alternate blocks of color. Red, blue, yellow, then checkerboards, and then nothing. I awoke to a million ants and grasshoppers doing a war dance across my body. I jerked as the contact pad fed me a massive jolt. My legs exploded. I lurched. Then was aware that the last contraction had snapped the bands lashing my legs to the slant board. Gurgling noises rose from my throat. The white-coated Dr. Savage came over. I waited until he was close, hooked my right foot between his thighs, and drew him closer.
Hey!
Kicked out with my left foot, striking with the instep. Dr. Savage gasped. His head snapped back. He groaned and fell on me. Glendon came rushing over. I let the doctor drop and hooked him with my right foot. His mouth opened in surprise. I shut it with an ankle kick. Got both legs around him and squeezed until his eyes bulged. Cut me loose, Glendon, or I'll kick you. He looked at the inert Dr. Savage on the floor and believed me. My hands were still palsied when Glendon cut them free, but I gave him a wrist, palm, heel, and sword peak hand anyway. He went down like a sack. Ernie, the husky guard, walked in carrying another of those wicked little shot glasses. When he saw Glendon and the doctor on the floor, he came charging. I waited and timed it with a perfect high kick, catching him flush on the jaw with the ball of my foot. He buckled forward. I gave him the inverted fist strike to the spleen. He turned green and I toppled him like a tree with a chop. Got to my feet, leaned over and pulled Glendon up. Where's Pam Clayton?
I don't know. She isn't here. We let her go.
What's it all about? Why hold her and cover up her appointment?
It wasn't my idea. I had to.
Who's behind it? Who gave you the orders? Don't go away, Glendon. Ernie began to stir. I picked up the little shot glass and shoved it down his throat. He gurgled but swallowed it. I wouldn't have any further worry about him. Then I strapped Glendon onto the slant board.
No, please. Please, don't turn it on.
Then talk. Before I blacked out of my room, I saw a man with you. His name is Dorn. Works for Lewis Charnock. Does Dorn have a piece of your action here?
No. He was here for a rubdown.
Come off it. You admitted snatching Pam Clayton wasn't your idea. Now, who are you fronting for? Whose idea was it?
Mr. Dorn suggested. He didn't explain his plan to me. I had to do it.
Why? You've got yourself a good thing here. How come you take orders from Charnock and Dorn? They got something on you, is that it? Either you cooperate or they blow the whistle on you, something like that.
Please.
Or is it a blackmail ring? Your rich patrons, their hang-ups, booze, drugs, sex. As director here, you'd know all the dirt. And their financial ratings, too. Well, are you going to talk?
Mr. Dorn.
You're saying Dorn. You mean Charnock, don't you?
Please, let me up.
Maybe I'll just plug you in for a while, loosen you up.
No.
No?
There is no pain.
Mr. Roper, I know nothing.
You had the Clayton kid doped up. What then? A set of compromising pictures to make her old man cough up a lot of loot?
No, it wasn't nothing like that. No, she was given sedation to keep her quiet, that's all.
What did you give her, a shot like you gave me?
Yeah. I told her that there was a personal phone call for her in my office, and while she waited, I gave her a cola with the drug.
How did you explain it to her when she came to?
Well, we had one of our staff handle it. He told her that she had fainted, that there was, some new mysterious virus going around. She believed us, and she left.
Well, she hasn't returned yet. Did you know that? Was she driving her own car?
Yeah, it's a green convertible. Now, I assumed that she'd be going straight home.
You assume rotten. Pam Clayton wasn't your only client with money. Why was she picked, and why Labor Day?
I don't know.
What about Tom Hunter? You're not going to answer, Mr. Glendon? All right, let's see. How do you turn this thing on?
No. He is inside. It's the last room, ground floor number 11.
Your teeth are chattering, Glendon. After what you put me through, I ought to just...
I'll tell you. I'm going to tell you everything. Now, see, Hunter suspected that we had Miss Clayton here. Well, he started to take the place apart. We had to jump him. We had to quiet him down.
You let the girl go. Why not Hunter?
Orders. They were afraid that he'd make trouble.
Who the hell is this guy Hunter, anyway?
I don't know.
What did you do to him?
Memory block. We were trying to erase his memory.
With this keen little machine?
No. Drugs and hypnosis. What we call condition regression.
You're going to take me to him, Glendon, right now. I unbuckled the straps. Glendon's knees almost caved in as he stood up, but he led me back to my room. I locked him in the closet while I dressed. My bag had been searched, but they overlooked my gun in the false bottom. I nudged Glendon with it. He nodded politely and led me to the room at the far end of the corridor. He unlocked the door, and I waved him in. A man was lying on the bed, staring listlessly at the ceiling. He matched the description Joey Zale had given me, except his face was now pale and haggard, eyes rimmed with dark circles. A wide gauze bandage topped his skull. What's under the bandage? A small hole bored in his skull? Electrode implants for altering behavior?
No, it's nothing like that. He put up a fight and banged his head falling. It was just a mild concussion at the waist. And he didn't respond to hypnosis at all. There are some like that, you know.
Tough. So why is he so listless?
Narcotics. He's in a stupor. It's going to wear off in a day or so. I assure you, he's going to be all right.
Mr. Hunter? Maybe you did better than you thought, Glendon.
No, now see, he's coming around.
Who are you?
Friend of Willie's, Willie Rich.
Willie Rich?
Come on, Glendon. Help me get him dressed.
No, not leaving, not without the kid.
Pam Clayton's not here. Take my word for it. I'm Willie Rich's friend. Come on, Hunter. Up you go. Pam's probably home by now. You want to see Pam, don't you? Night shift will be coming on. We got to get out of here.
Pam. See Pam.
Okay, Glendon, you lead the way. It was a short walk down the hall to the side exit, but it seemed miles, burdened by Hunter's confused condition. As we hit the cool night air, Hunter's legs buckled and he went limp. Glendon helped me shove him into my car. I could see he was looking around, nervously. Don't worry, Glendon. I'll explain it all to Charnock and Dorn when I catch up with them. You've got a bigger worry. Something you should really be nervous about. Who killed Bonnie Burns?
What? No, you're joking.
A knife in the back's a bad joke. I found her up at Lake Tahoe. Did they tell you that was how she'd spend her vacation? Dead?
Well,
You're being played for a patsy, Glendon. You can get 10 to 20 as an accessory. Who told you to let Bonnie off? I heard a rustle behind us in the dark shrubbery separating the parking lots. Something whistled, glittered in the night. It thudded heavily close to me. Glenn's mouth opened in a surprised scream that aborted suddenly as he coughed and fell against me. He sagged, pulling my arms down with him, and I couldn't find my gun. I judged the knife on his back to have at least a 6-inch blade. Glendon was coughing frothy red bubbles. His dead eyes stared at me accusingly, as if I'd asked him one question too many. Allie Riegel opened his door, then followed me down his driveway and helped me carry Tom Hunter into his house. We bedded him down on the living room couch. Turning to leave, I knocked a magazine of local coming events off the coffee table. A lucky accident. It told me Charnock was in San Diego, a 10-minute ride away. I had questions for Charnock about Hunter. Took me longer than I'd expected to get to the theater. The lobby lights were out, cars were driving away. I stopped my car abruptly. Lewis Charnock was getting into his long black car. Dorn wasn't with him. The car took off down the Embarcadero north along the riverfront. There were plenty of hotels in San Diego, but Charnock was heading out of the city. I tailed him up Highway 101. The limo swung off the causeway where a curving ramp led to a sumptuous bayside motor hotel, the Bahia Bay. He pulled into a parking stall at the far end, fronting a dark bungalow. I stopped, doused my lights, watched Charnock get out, say goodnight to his chauffeur, and go inside. The chauffeur lit a toke, leaned back against his seat, and enjoyed the quiet night. His hand, holding the butt, dangled outside the open car window when I came up. I slammed his wrist to the side of the car, leaned in with a solid left, smashing his nose, aborting his outcry. I slugged him again, yanked the door open, and he was out cold. One thing about the bloodletting business, it never hurts to catch a sucker off guard. I removed his belt, lashed his hands together with it, dumped him over into the back seat. Charnock opened his bungalow door to my knock. When he saw my gun, he backed up fast, and I shut the door behind me, locking it. I had a lot of questions to ask you the last time we met. We never got to them. Now I have several more. Let's start with George Glendon. What's your connection with him?
George who?
Glendon. Glendon. Try harder. He runs the spa at Poway, the Gilded Cuckoo. He seems to be running errands for you, too.
I'm sorry, Mr. Roper, isn't it? I don't know Glendon or what you're talking about.
How about Pam Clayton? Does that ring a bell?
I know Monica Clayton, but then we've known each other for years.
This gun can go off, you know. I was given a pretty good going over at the Gilded Cuckoo by the same Mr. Glendon I mentioned, so don't tell me you don't know what I'm talking about, because I've heard differently. Also, while I was getting that going over, I happened to see your friend Dorn.
Well, that's quite possible. Mr. Dorn might have some interest there. He has many outside interests. None of them concern me.
Let's try some other names. Bonnie Burns, Tom Hunter.
I'm sorry, I don't know them.
Does Dorn?
I suggest you ask him.
I will when I get to him. But Dorn works for you, and you're the boss as far as I'm concerned. Pam Clayton was abducted, so was Hunter. Bonnie Burns was killed, and now Glendon's got a knife in his hand.
I find all that very distressing, but I don't know any of these people.
I'm a private investigator, Charnock. On Labor Day, a friend of mine, Willie Rich, was drowned in his swimming pool. I don't think it was his idea. Somehow, I think you're involved. Tyler Clayton's daughter disappeared the same day. Monica Clayton asked me to find her. She had an appointment at the beauty spa. Glendon told me she never got there, but admitted later to keeping her a prisoner. Said that he was acting on orders of higher-ups and implicated you and Dorn. I personally saw Monica Clayton at the theater with you the following day.
She didn't come to see me. She came to see Dorn.
Why?
I imagine to bring him some money.
Blackmail?
It's been going on for a long time. It's not quite like you think. Mr. Dorn uses me for a front. I happen to be the convenience. Perhaps I can explain our relationship.
As he explained it, I had the feeling that Charnock felt relieved to finally be able to tell someone. It seemed that 25 years ago, he had committed an indiscretion with a minor, male, good for a morals rap. Wesley Dorn, a sharp and conniving lawyer, got the evidence and found himself in a position to put an end to young Charnock's platform career. But he was shrewd enough to sense a better arrangement, a partnership, with him calling the shots for Charnock.
I was a success from the start. Women gave me money, large amounts, remembered me in their wills, gave me real estate, businesses, insurance policies. It was incredible, really.
And you never got a dime out of it?
You might say just living expenses. Dorn has power of attorney over me.
Yeah, you could have got out. Dorn didn't make you write books about what you do. You could have come up with a sore throat or something at your lectures. You don't sound like a prisoner to me.
Oh, don't misunderstand, please. I believe in my messages, my books, my lectures. Like it or not, Dorn has made it possible for me to continue my work. Despite his hold on me, I sincerely believe I've helped many people.
Mm. You told me Monica Clayton's paying off Dorn, too. What's he got on her?
Some porno films from a long time ago. She bought them back, then found out Dorn reproduced the negatives.
Mm. He's had her on the hook all these years?
Yes. Monica has been rather careless at different stages of her life. She's picked up some bad habits. I have nothing to fear from you, Mr. Roper. Apparently, Wesley Dorn has.
Where is Dorn now?
He has a houseboat in the cove, a short distance off the pier. It's called the Sea Serpent. You can't miss it even at night. It's positively unique.
After leaving Charnock, I looked into the back of his car to see how his chauffeur was doing. He was gone. When I got to the pier, I expected J.J. to be waiting for me. He wasn't. I found a small boat with oars. I made like Captain Bly and headed for a large gray shape with bright lights 100 yards out in the bay. The sea serpent was camping and attractive. The deck was an extended front porch. There were shutters on the windows and potted plants. A front door and living room covered with brilliant red carpeting. Dorn was lying on it. Face up, a lot of it missing above the eyes. I was a little disappointed, but not too surprised. Two bullets had pinpointed in his forehead, putting an end to this stage of the investigation, not to mention Dorn. Well, one less suspect, one more corpse. Now is the time for another one of my failings. No such luck. I was right back where I started. Nowhere.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Princess Stakes Murder. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is Mutual, your news and sports radio network.